Hey guys, welcome once again. This is one of the video series on how to select a diode for a particular application. We have seen the selection process of the rectifier diode, Zener diode and Schottky diode so far. Well, this time we'll discuss the varistor diodes. Their working principle, how are they used in an overvoltage protection device, its advantages, disadvantages and what is the selection criteria. They are also known as the varistor and generally used for the protection of a circuit. So let's get started. Many of you may know the component named MOV, which is nothing but a metal oxide varistor. Its resistance varies according to the voltage applied to its terminals. In this diagram, when initially as voltage increases, the resistance decreases exponentially and it acts as a short circuit. Due to this unique property of varistor, it is also known as voltage dependent resistance. However, the relation between voltage and resistance is not linear. Hence, it becomes little tricky. Under normal condition, varistor acts as an open circuit having high impedance. The varistor comes into picture when a sudden voltage transient occurs in the circuit. Then resistance of the varistor decreases and voltage increases. It locks the voltage to a safe level, protecting components connected across it. The varistor is a bidirectional component, which comes handy in both AC and DC circuits. It comes with different packages. Mostly they come in radial shape, which looks like a ceramic capacitor. The MOVs are available in a wide range of operating voltages from 10 volt to 1000 volts. The varistor can be connected directly across main supply and semiconductor devices such as transistors for protection. Hence, MOVs are used in a bridge rectifier, SMPS, high power current converters, motor controller, and the list goes on. Nowadays, MOVs used largely in the industry. As name suggests, it is made of metal oxides, generally a zinc oxide. You must be thinking, what is transient? Well, the transient voltages are temporary voltage spikes which occur in the circuit due to source fluctuation, lightning strikes, inductive load switching, electrostatic discharges, etc., etc. The effect of this transient could be very dangerous and can destroy important circuits. The structure of MOV is crystalline, which consists of randomly oriented small metal oxide grains, which are conductors separated by a resistor intergranule boundary. These boundaries exhibit PN junction semiconductor characteristics. Well, when the voltage is in the range of rated value, only a small amount of current flows through the MOV caused by a reverse leakage through the junction. But when a high transient voltage that exceeds the varistor's breakdown voltage is applied, then avalanche breakdown occurs at the junctions. And the MOV clamps the voltage to a safe level as it conducts. There are several advantages of MOV, such as they are most effective at protecting circuits which require higher capacitance. They are very cost effective. But MOV only protects a circuit when there is a voltage surge for a small amount of time. It cannot offer protection against a continuous voltage surge, which can be present for a remarkable time period. Even if the voltage is significantly lower than the transient voltages for which it is designed for, then it may lead to a problematic state. And putting all of those parameters in mind, we can check the selection criteria of the MOV. First is the rated voltage. It is also known as maximum continuous voltage. It is maximum continuous AC or DC voltage permissible across MOV, where it acts as an open circuit. it depends on the working voltage of the circuit, and you can select according to that. This value differs from both AC and DC signals. Next is the clamping voltage. It is the voltage across the varistor's terminals at which it becomes a closed circuit and current doesn't flow through the parallel components present in the circuit, and it protects those from exposing to very high voltage. It is basically the voltage where you need to cut down the excess voltage. Third is the surge current. It is the maximum peak current applied for a certain pulse duration that can be applied without MOV being failed. That means when there is a surge voltage rise in the circuit, the MOV acts as a short circuit, which allows the flow of an enormous amount of current till the transient state passes by. This current flows for a very short time in the MOV. If it flows for longer time mentioned in the datasheet, then there are very high chances that MOV will fail, but it protects the other devices. This enormous amount of current is known as the surge current. It is mentioned in the datasheet with the condition of time period. Next is the leakage current. Even if when it is act as an open circuit, a small amount of current flows through the MOV. This current is known as the leakage current. It should be very low as possible to minimize the power dissipation. Ideally, it should be zero. Next is the response time. It is the time taken by MOV to jump from non-conductive state to a conductive state after transient voltage occurred across it. That is how fast MOV gets short-circuited when there is a voltage spike. This value should be as minimum as possible so that the circuit should get protected without destroying any other components connected across it. Well, there are some limitations of the MOV as well. As its clamping voltage is very high, hence they cannot be used in small signal circuits like embedded systems. MOVs are passive devices and they degrade over time, even when they are used within their specifications. Well, to overcome these limitations, we use TVS diodes, which we'll discuss in the next session. Till then, stay tuned. If you like this video, hit the like button. Comment down if you have any queries. Subscribe to my channel. And finally, thanks for watching.